have bankers ask us all the time, you're going to be dropping that .com from your name? Well, why? Well, it's really really holding you back on Wall Street because it's so out of favor, this .com world. Wall Street is a very important audience for us, but it's not the most important audience. The most important audience are our customers. And every time someone says our name, whether it's Anna introducing me here today or it's the Wall Street Journal and this big feature story they're doing on us next week, when they say 1-800-Flowers.com or when they write 1-800-Flowers.com, they're telling you two ways that you can sample our service. We don't always get everything right at 800-Flowers. Sometimes we screw up. When we do, we try and make our best customers are things that we screwed up on and made right for them, even if it wasn't our fault. I got a letter from a lady one time who wrote this wonderful, flattering letter about a lady who works for us. Her name is Barbara. Barbara's a pretty tough bird, been with us a dozen years, supervisor on one of our night shifts in one of our service centers. I know her well. And I get this letter about Barbara, and this nurse, a triage nurse, tells me, it says, I'm a triage nurse. Here's what I do for a living. But it's all about helping people get to them quickly, assess the situation, make decisions antiseptically without concern for emotions, et cetera. And I called up, and I was really mad that you guys had screwed up. And I was vitriolic. I was even probably vulgar. And I vented on Barbara big time. And I told you guys, screwed up. Barbara, listen to me. 8, 9, 10 minutes, calmed me down and said, look, I'll make it right for you. She got the flowers out to my mother the next day. She sent me a rose and a bud vase with a note, I'm sorry you're upset, I hope this made up for things. She goes, it was only a couple of days later I learned up. I had screwed up. I gave you the wrong address. Barbara knew that and never said anything to me about it. It didn't matter. It wasn't about who was right. It was a matter of making me feel good. And she says, here I am, a professional who's supposed to be able to deal with these things. And I just want to tell you, if you have more people like Barbara around, I'll be a customer forever. Well, that makes me feel good, and it makes me feel good to be the part of the business that we're in. So my job is to bring those stories and populate them to Alamogordo and tell them about Catherine over in that facility in Ardmore, Oklahoma, and tell you about Barbara and tell all of our other people about Barbara. When we do customer service training, we give people a manual. And the manual is, all it is copies of letters that I've gotten from customers, and we have about a dozen of them now, real thick manuals. And everyone says, there are no rules here in customer service. And we say, that's right. What are the rules? And I said, the rules are, read these letters that I get from customers. Your objective should be, when you're handling that issue, is to cause the customer who you're working with to write me a letter to tell me how fantastic you were. The earliest recollection I have of being intersecting with the flower business, because most people who are in the business grew up in it, and I did not. But I remember someone asked me recently we were doing a newspaper interview, and they said, well, what was your first recollection of being aware of the power and the impact that flowers can have on people's lives? And I said, well, I'll tell you what it was. It was an impact on my life. And she said, well, go ahead, tell me the story. So I said, well, I don't know if it was my first real date, but it was real close to my first real date in high school. And I dated a gal named Margaret Sullivan who lived in Woodside, Queens. I was living in South Ozone Park, and I had to take a bus and change to get the subway and then change to get the elevator train to go to her house. So here I am, I get to the subway station. On the mezzanine level, not the track level, the in-between level of the subway station in Kew Gardens was a little flower stand where my neighbor and friend, Joey Giuliano, worked. So I stopped to see Joey Giuliano, and I said, Joe, I'm going to take this girl. We're going to go to the movies. We're going to go to the movies, and we're going to go to Jan's Ice Cream Parlor afterwards. I'd like to bring her a bouquet. And so I brought this bouquet over to Margaret's house, and I was a nervous wreck. She lived on the third floor of this apartment building in Woodside, and I remember going up the stairs, and I felt the nerves in my knees. And I had this bouquet, and I'm not sure if the paper was all tattered from the sweat on my palms or from the water on the stems of the flowers, but I remember ringing the doorbell to Margaret's apartment, and she came out, and she sees the bouquet, and her face lights up, and she grabs the bouquet and gives it a smell, and then she grabs me and pulls me over and kisses me on the cheek, and I sort of stumbled back and started away, and she said, what's the matter, did I do something wrong? I said, no, you wait here. I'm going for more flowers. Because it's then I realized this is a business I want to be in. When I first moved into that group home, I was afraid. I thought I was going to get killed. I thought I was going to cause someone who was in my care to be hurt or killed. And it happened. And I've said, I'm out of here. So I went to the fellow who ran the home, who was the fellow who sort of took me in under his wing. His name was Brother Tom Traeger. He was a member of a religious order. And I went to Brother Tom. I said, I have to leave this work. And he said, you're not leaving. He said, you have a heart for this, you care about this work, and you can learn to be good at this work. So he took me on his wing and he started painting pictures for me of, well, who's successful? Let's look around at all our other group homes and see who are the people who are successful at this work, and let's see how their behavior is different from yours. And one of the first things I saw was I was reactive. I'd come to work at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. It's a two-story brick house in the middle of a very, very bad neighborhood. And I had these 10 guys in there. I was only a few months older than the oldest guy in the home. I had to make sure he didn't know that. I grew the beard to look older. It's still working real well. And I'd come to work, and if a fight broke out, I'd go and try and break it up. Or if something happened here, I'd go and deal with that. The school called about a problem, I'd go and deal with that. But I just sort of bounced around, floated around, waiting for things to happen, and then I'd try and react to them. But the people who were successful at this work weren't doing that. They had a plan. They came to work with a plan. Now, did they always get to execute against that plan? No. But if they had a plan, they had a much better shot of controlling the agenda. And so I had to find a way to do that, too. And the second thing I noticed about them was, and he pointed out to me, is I tried to react to this group as a group of 10. And I tried to herd them. And I didn't really develop relationships with any one of them. Brother Tom said to me,